life of the church or the community. Yes,
Judy should not send so long to everybody. She misses everybody and she puts someone by the boxes. She thought she got rid of her Jackson.
Okay, so Judy Schumann says hello and greetings, and she's surrounded by foxes, apparently followed her from New Hampshire down to New Jersey.
Foxes.
Boxes. I thought she said boxes. I thought that's a much more exciting story. I was pictured with little red foxes that they follow. Other announcements for the life of the church or the community. Because this is a different kind of morning, and so we do our prayers differently, and we're not going to have prayers of the people per se, I just want to let you know that Tish Hanlon's father died on Friday evening, Michael Hanlon. So please hold Tish and her family in your prayers. He had been on hospice a long time. He was in his 90s, and he was ready to go, but it is always, always hard to say goodbye to the person you love. So regardless of how prepared people think they are, hold them in your prayers. Okay, so a funeral for Father John Goffrey, the prior pastor of Our Lady of the Mountains, with a wake today, a wake tomorrow, and a funeral following at 11 a.m. on Monday. So we're sure doing prayers to people now, so if there's anything that you really want us to hold in prayer, let's just raise it up right now. Alright, and here's what we're going to do. Today is a special day. We're starting a worship series that's going to be about discovering God through butchers, bakers, and fresh food makers. And it's going to go for about 8 weeks. And we're going to begin and end with brunch church. So today it's brunch church, but it's also Ukama Sunday. The combination is that we have partnership with a church in Zimbabwe. And so we celebrate that partnership. We try to raise them up in prayer every single week. But we also, once a year, celebrate in a more robust way our connection to this wonderful partner church. So we're going to have guest music by Chris and Jeanette, and we're going to listen to them play for once. And then while we're all happily exiting out to the parish house where we're going to do the rest of our service around the table, because this is a festive way of worshiping together, they'll continue playing. So please enter into a space of preparedness and being present to the festival and festive and communal nature of today's worship together. And if you two would pray, play for us. Thank you.
what closet we're at.
Yeah, sit wherever you want. Stand up, make yourself at home. We try to sit together, you know, sit apart from each other. We don't have enough people to go along.
I was on the same.
Thank you.
Damien, Josiera, Rini, Marini, Amiri. And possibly the people that speak that language might have understood some of our words, but that, I believe, understands all of our intention to lift up God's name in prayer in any language. This is the time when you name what you hope for a gathering around the table like this. We are small but mighty today, so what would you pray and hope for when we gather around the table in conversation and community? Nina and the
community. Deep friendship.
Deep friendship.
Peace.
Peace.
Love.
Love.
Prosperity.
Prosperity.
Unity.
Unity.
Hope.
Hope.
Fellowship.
Fellowship.
Good food.
Good food. Yes. That's good. Comfort.
Strong faith.
Strong faith. Remembering our partners. Remembering that we are unified, not just here, but in other parts of the world, sitting down together.
Appreciation.
Appreciation.
Understanding all of what everyone here contributes to make this church better.
Understanding of all that is contributed by the different people to make this community and this church what it is.
Perspective.
Perspective. Says a man sitting over there watching the whole table. I can tease him because he's not asking. Anything else you want to add? Then let us gather in prayer. O holy God, you are known by countless names, by so many different tongues, and in so many different ways. We each know you in our own way, and you know us intimately, and you call us into community, and you honor and give us different gifts that we may offer our own strengths into this community, and through our diversity become greater than we are as individuals. We ask for your intimate presence here at this table. We ask that you will bless the food that is offered here, the lives that are offered here, and remind us of the people that gather at other tables in other places all around the world, in your name, by whatever name we know and call you. We give thanks. Amen. Now that we've done that, we're going to do a responsive reading to bless the meal, and then you get to get up and get your food and pull your plates, and the rest is more or less a conversation with some added parts. The idea of this is that we have courageous conversations. So there are scriptures in here, and we're going to ask you guys to talk about them, and talk about what they mean along the way today. So let us go into the blessing. Open my eyes that they may see the deepest needs of the people.
Move my hands that they may feed the hungry.
Touch my heart that it may bring warmth to the despairing.
Teach me generosity that helps strangers.
Let me share my possessions to clothe the naked.
Give me the care of strangers for sick.
Make me share in the quest to set the prisoner free.
In sharing our anxieties and our love, our poverty and our prosperity, we partake of your loving presence.
Amen. So feel free to get up and grab a plate and fill your bowl and your plate with food. There is one dish that at least is from Zimbabwe. It's a peanut stew. It's all vegetarian. And there's rice next to it, so you might want to spoon some rice to go with it and give it a whirl. Go for it.
Thank you.
am not. I'm God. You gained this good, broke my lips, I was not starting to pray. Yeah, I come in tonight.
Remember that what we're going to be doing is a worship series. And we're going to be talking about meeting God through the fruits of creation, through the things that we use to nurture our bodies and our lives. And we'll focus on different foods every week. But today we're starting with just the conversation about the common table. Next week we're going to have World Communion Sunday with breads from all over the world. Mary Eads is going to be leading that service, and we're going to be talking about what bread means in different cultures and what it means in our faith life. But today we think about sort of that world communion and that open table that is available to everybody, and that in our tradition, no one is turned away. You can come. You don't have to have been baptized or say you believe in a specific thing. You can come to this table just as you are, and be welcome here, because God is bigger than our labels and our words and our boxes. And so today, I'm going to invite each portion of the table. and read that together and talk about that in conversation. I'm going to ask this table to put the fourth one down, read that together quietly, and then you're going to talk about what it means. I'm going to ask this part of the table to flip the page and maybe read these two together. And then I'm going to ask this part of the table to talk about the last one. The last one. You guys are going to talk about this together. And you guys are going to go back to the very first Corinthians passage. Yep. Read that together and talk about it. And what you're trying to tie together is what you hear in the scripture and what it means for our table and our community and our lives to be open to different people and different gifts, and to acknowledge that even when we are called into unity, we are called into unity with room and space and honoring of our diversity, right? So just read the scripture and then go wherever it leads you in terms of that conversation.
Yes. Everything, and the fact that we can understand how various parts work together. a new broker, a holy body, and then you're playing tennis, you stepped on the wrong thing, hit your foot, and then you have to go to work and all that stuff. Yes, you recognize, you know, the person with the, you know, no foot or whatever is what you can do. So for a month or two, going to work and everything else is a difficult task. You start realizing how lucky you were, but you never had a problem in your life. Real serious ways of helping what they feel, you know.
But even that can have, like, change your perspective, right? That's what we're talking about. I mean, have humility and realize that you have to depend on other people. You have to depend on other people to get things done when not other people are working out. What sort of came up for this?
Well, we had two. The first one was that each individual, like, body part or person, when they all come together, were bigger and stronger and better. Honoring the weaker spokesperson, the person that we need otherwise, but the people, the other dogs, the worker being traumatized. That's what we said about it.
Okay, so the importance of recognizing the significance of different people, the worker beings, and that every day the survivor is like the big superhero leader. That everybody has is part of contributing to that interdependence and strength of community.
Me? I'm a little saddened by it.
What makes you sad, Lord?
What makes me sad is that it's so wonderful to think that that could possibly be. It was meant to be, they said it was meant to be, that we all respected each other and each member was important and that we listened to one another and there was no dissension within the body, that the members, they have the same care for one another. It's our ultimate goal in life. And I don't know if I see it as much as I want to see it in everybody else.
So while it's a goal, it's something that we're still trying to strive towards, but we still want to achieve. I mean, I'd be proud of it all. All experience that reality, we fall short of that ideal, but it is an ideal to strive for. And this is reminding us of that ideal. What came up over here?
I talked about when I went to Zimbabwe, and you come up means that we all may be one. So kind of as joining together. But what we talked about was in the partnership, you think of it as an exchange. And we're so wealthy compared to Zimbabwe, and it was like, what could they possibly give to us as in an exchange? And what we discovered was their faith is so strong and their community is so loving that it was overwhelming the gifts that they gave to us.
In fact, if you look at around the tables, you will see objects that Jeanette brought back from Zimbabwe. Many of these were given, I would say, out of households, and sometimes people had very little. They might have had a few cooking utensils, and they gave away their cooking utensils, the daily objects, to Jeanette to bring back to us, where they sit on a shelf. And their sort of arts and their curiosities and their museum pieces. But over there are their everyday pieces that would be used for serving food, preparing food. They gave away parts of their everyday selves to us. Which is why we bring them down. When we play music, we bring the musical instruments down. We try to use them, not every week, but we really try to notice them and pay attention to what was offered to us and continues to be offered to us in that partnership. else you guys want to add? Mario or Kathleen?
Chris did a good job figuring out the end part of the scripture, but the beginning part, I understood, but I put it in simpler terms, you know, at least in the church, when one of us suffers, we all suffer together, and, you know, when one of us is honored, we're all honored together. But it's also like that when you're out in your life, too, with maybe your work or your coworkers, you know, if one of you suffers, all of you suffer in a way, and if one of you is honored, you can all be honored if you choose it to be that way. It can be that way in life outside of the church too, but the church is most important because I think this is where we all get our strength.
Okay.
So we talked about a couple of things, how each person in the congregation, the church, has a different function, and they're not all alike, kind of like just one talked to and one.
That's bringing it back around.
but it's like a physical body. You have organs, but each organ has a different function. And if one of those organs is failing,
so I want to circle us back to what it means to be welcoming, and that again, this is an ideal that we strive for, and we think of our church as being friendly and hospitable and welcoming, and our town as being hospitable and welcoming. And obviously, hospitality is a huge part of our economy. I mean, it's what we do for a living. We open our community and make it beautiful, and we feed people, and we throw parties, and we help them celebrate the important days in their lives. But I just want to point out a couple of examples of where our community has a history of not doing its best, and then how to look at itself in a different way. And one was the story, and forgive me if you've heard this before, but Sasha shared the story. Will you share the story about your father coming here, needing a place to stay? Do you mind sharing that?
He was lost at that point. And it was late at night, came through the Jackson Bridge, and at that time, you had both Grace and the Birth Hall, and they were both functioning. Opened. The Depression was going on. It was before World War II. Exactly when, I don't know. Say the late 30s. And he went to, well, one of the hotels. He was one of the car. And he parked his big, big car, and he had made a lot of money by then, and people knew his name. So when he got to the hotel, he went in, and a gentleman behind the desk said, helping to suggest that I have a room, he said, certainly, sir. And in those days, they gave you a big book. He turned it around, he had my father sign the book. And I guess you paid cash, I don't know, it was in those days. And once my father signed it, and he turned the book around, he looked and he recognized his name. And he looked up at him and he said, I'm sorry, there is no room for you to have. And my father, knowing it was because he was a Jew and that no Jews were allowed at one of the hotels. So he said, please, it was late at night, I will leave by 5:30 in the morning, I'm tired and I'm lame. Just let me sleep here, no one will see me, and I'll leave. And he said, no, I'm sorry, I can't break the rule, not even for you. So my father went out, and he's left going. All right, he slept in his car all that night, and then he wandered back down 16 into North Conway, so he thought that was the center of business, and he went to the bank, and he said to the people at the bank, I'd like to talk to somebody about mortgages. So he got the gentleman, and my father said, is there a mortgage on the Wentworth Hall? And they said, well, of course there is, and being the Depression, no said, "Boy, you turned crazy and experienced." And we're like, "In that one." And well, how much was that? He says, "Okay, I've got enough," and he paid that one up. And he came back to Jackson. He went back to the Wetwood Hall, and he walked in, and he said, "That's the manager." The manager came. I thought I told him what happened the night before. And he said, "I have just been to the bank, and now I'm holding your mortgage." So my father put it down, and he said, "And I demand the payment now." And of course, they couldn't pay. So my father says, "Get up." In an orderly fashion, we got him one hour, but when he came in, the two hotels.
But what you need to hear in that story is one that despite our history of hospitality and our inns are a lot older than Sasha's story, for all that time, no Jewish person was allowed to own a business, stay at a hotel. And there was a third thing that, and they were publicly outlawed. This was a law, and it was enforced. And so our community was closed to an entire group of people because of their faith and their background. And what Sasha's father did with the gifts and the strengths that he had was to challenge and change and upset that order. And Jackson became one of the places where the Jewish community found roots. And because the doors were open to them, welcome. And they made a home and they established themselves here. So we have a history of both resisting and othering people and saying you're not welcome. And then because people take a stand, and sometimes they do it in a tough way because there is no middle ground, open the doors for others. A year ago, we have a hotel here, and the contributions to the hate crime where, some guests were turned away because they were perceived to be Muslim and terrorists probably had to do with mental health conditions, also with a lot of sort of understanding or believing headlines and propaganda in specific ways. But again, one of our hotels turned people away because of their perceived identity, not because of who they were, but because of the groups that they belonged to. And so, and then we have rules that hold us accountable for that kind of action, but it doesn't mean it isn't happening. And so even though we think of ourselves as a welcoming church and a welcoming community, examples as recently as 1 year ago sometimes tell us that there are embedded biases, that there are things that we aren't aware of or things that we still have to work on and stand up for in order to be as open as a community, as a church, and to set a place at the table for everyone as possible. You guys have done amazing conversations. You went into different places and you brought it home to your own lives. Remember that our community has both this history of being welcoming, but also being on the wrong side of welcoming. And that we continue to work towards this ideal of an open, inclusive, hospitable place to be. And that we have work to do, but that we have an ideal and a framework that helps to guide us. And that this is who we are called to be at our best. And we're working on it. And we're pretty good at it most of the time. And sometimes we get it wrong, but then we get a chance to get it right the next time. And that's who we are. And that's what Ukama means. Ukama also means in time and place, extended family, unity and connectedness, not just in the present day, but acting in the present day on behalf of the generations yet to come. Ukama implies that what we do now changes and opens up the world for our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren and the generations that are ahead of us. So Ukama matters here and now in this place, just like it does in Zimbabwe. And thank you for your conversation. We are going to dedicate the offerings that have been made already, but in case you can throw something in the basket, there are baskets and bowls all around here. You're more than welcome to add to the offering if you haven't done so already.
Thank you.
Thank you.